Hello. This week, I'm joined by the delightful Jordan Gonsalves, who is a journalist and podcaster with a very interesting take on Lady Gaga and how she helped him feel accepted and loved as a queer person. Is that about right?
I love that.
Cool. Off we go then. This is Probably True. Please be aware that the following contains strong language and adult themes. It would be boring without them.
This story starts when I was 14 years old and I was living in Houston, Texas. That's where I grew up. And I remember 14, 13 years old, that's kind of when you start like really getting into, you start really discovering what music you love. And I remember I had just seen the Video Music Awards, the 2009 Video Music Awards. And this was the award show when Kanye had interrupted Taylor Swift and Beyonce had given this like amazing performance of Single Ladies. This was also the year that Lady Gaga had done her like blood-soaked performance of Paparazzi. And I was gagged at 14 years old. I had no idea that I was gay. I mean, I think up until that point, like everyone had told me, you know, you're gay, like my childhood bullies and stuff, but I was, you know, living my life. I was living my best life. And so, but this performance, it had like ignited something in me. So I remember a few months later, her video for Bad Romance came out and I was obsessed. Oh my God, I was obsessed. And these were the days where we didn't have smartphones yet. So I think it was like maybe like a year or two before. I think the iPhone actually had come out, but not very many people had it. It wasn't as accessible. So if you wanted to watch music videos, you'd go home and, you know, watch them on YouTube on your computer. And so I remember I would go home and watch this music video on repeat on my family computer for hours. And I would like identify all the things that I had missed from the last time that I watched it that I didn't notice. Oh my God, I was so obsessed, like the words and the music and the fashion and the choreography. It was just, it was amazing. And I then like dived into all of her discography and her catalog. It was just, I was obsessed. Like she was becoming my queen. And so she had embarked on a world tour at that point. It was called the Monster Ball World Tour. And I was pretty obsessed. I think all the kids at my school were starting to notice that I was really obsessed. But at the same time, I was really afraid of being sort of called gay. I grew up in a very conservative environment. My family are immigrants from India. So this is a very traditional sort of heteronormative patriarchy kind of vibe that happens in Indian families. So there was that. I also grew up in the American South in Texas. And in addition, I grew up super Catholic too. So very religious. So there's a lot of shame around being gay, and I never wanted to be gay. I think from an early age, all the messages that I received about being gay were pretty horrible and scary. You'd either die of AIDS or you'd die alone. And, you know, I didn't want that for myself at that age. So I tried my very best to conceal as much as I could and sort of hide the fact that, you know, I had, what do they call it? A limp wrist. Like one of those. Yeah. Yeah. The audience, I don't know if they can see me, but I'm bending my wrist, flicking my wrist.
You do it so professionally as well. Like it seems so natural on you.
It is natural. Apparently I was born that way. but
see what you did then.
Anyway, so I think of that, you know, as I started to really like her music and sort of talk about it, people would sort of make fun of me for it. And it began to be something that I hid and I didn't tell anyone at all. But one day there was an opportunity to buy concert tickets to her show. And I remember they sold out in like a minute. I couldn't get them. It was like a minute that this whole arena sold out of her tickets. I was like, shit. I remember skipping class to go buy the tickets. Like, we had one computer lab in our school. And I went up to the computer lab and I lied to the teacher. And I was like, oh, like, I'm here to watch my uncle's funeral. Like, it's apparently being live streamed. I don't even think they had live streaming back then. This was like 2009. I was, meanwhile, on LadyGaga.com, like, vigorously pressing over and over again. So I didn't get the tickets, but I would go on her website every single day to figure out, like, if there was... you know, some new opportunity where new tickets were being released or something like that. Oh God, I was obsessed. I wonder now how much collective time I spent in my obsession over her in those teen years. So one day, you know, in I guess reward of my, I don't know what you call it, like my persistence, she had announced on her website and nowhere else that if you had volunteered with this organization that she had chosen in your city, you'd get free tickets to the show. And I was like, oh my God, I have to do this. So I ended up volunteering with this organization in Houston that had partnered with her. And they gave me 2 free tickets to the show. And they were like, you know, we can't promise that they're going to be good, but you're... basically you'll get them at the box office, but you have 2 free tickets to the show. So I didn't even care if they were like at the back of the nosebleeds. I really wanted to go. So I had this best friend at the time who was a fellow queer. we both didn't know back then. I don't know how it was. It was impossible not to know, but she was the one person in my high school that just truly unabashedly, unequivocally, and unconditionally accepted me for who I am. Her name is Adriana. And we're not so close now. You know, it's been so long since we both graduated and we both kind of went our own ways. But I will never forget that level of love. I think she was really the first person in my whole life that really accepted me and saw me for who I am. And so I asked her if she wanted to come with me. She said, hell yeah. And we were like, oh my God, what are we going to wear? Because at this point, you know, I'd been seeing things on YouTube of people showing up to her concerts, sort of like mimicking her outfits in her music videos and stuff. And so I was like, I don't know what I'm going to wear. But then the Telephone music video came out with Beyonce. And this was like gay iconology. This was gay iconography. Oh my God. Watching that video was everything. It was like, I just remember watching it when it came out. My mouth was on the ground. I was like, I didn't even know what it meant to be fed as a gay, but I was fed. I was stuffed after that, watching that music video. And so she had in that video, one of the outfits she had wore was this like leather jacket with a bunch of studs on it and stuff like that, and spikes. And she looked like this sort of like groupie of like a motorcycle gang. And I thought like, okay, that's what I'm going to do. That's what I'm going to wear. And I had no money to buy any of this stuff. And, you know, my parents weren't going to buy anything for me. So any costumes to go to this concert. I think they were at the time a little bit like, you know, I don't know if we like this lady because she's kind of grotesque and sort of like pushing the envelope a little too far. And you know, my parents are kind of conservative, so.
And there was that whole rumor that she had a dick as well. Like, I don't know if that was a thing in the US, but it was, because was it the telephone video was the one where like they strip her naked and like the jailer's like, see, I told you she had a dick or didn't have a dick or whichever way around it was. It was like, it was a really shocking, well, not shocking, but it was like for 2009 or whenever it was kind of like trans people. Ooh.
It, literally, yeah. And you know, I think back to that moment. It's funny you mentioned that, River. One, it's funny that you also know this video. So it is a gay icon holiday.
Of course, yeah. The telephone video is iconic. It's amazing. It really is.
And second of all, I remember her doing an interview with Anderson Cooper at that time where he actually asked her about it. And she was like, I'm not going to answer that. So what if I have a dick? Who cares? My fans don't care. And she was like, it might be really big. And I remember wow, that is amazing.
Sorry, enough about penis. Back to you.
No, she really was revolutionary and so ahead of her time. Like at a time when I think everyone was talking shit about trans people and being super transphobic, like she was one of the few people to come out and be like, you know, fuck you. That is not what I think or what I believe. I was obsessed with this music video, and I had found this thrift store with an old leather vest for $5, and I bought it, and I went to Hot Topic and I bought these studs from Hot Topic, and I didn't know how to stud a vest or a leather vest or anything like that. I'd never done anything like this before.
Okay, so these were proper ones, like they weren't just like stick on kind of.
No, they were a stud, and they had two spikes in them that you'd have to sort of like push into the seam of the leather and then close them, and you'd bend the spikes in order for them to stay.
Okay.
And so I spent days, like days, making this fucking vest. I remember, you know, now at the Met, you know, when they say like, oh, this took over 100 hours to make. Like that was me for this vest. I wish I had a picture actually to show you. But it came out so good. Oh my God. It came out so good. It was like this vest that was like, it fit me perfectly. And it was this black leather vest, and I had studs on the top and in the front. And I felt like I was in that telephone music video. And we went to the concert together, and it was like my first concert going sort of as by myself, like with a friend without my parents. We get to the concert, and it was just so amazing. It was really like nothing I had ever experienced before. I mean, an arena of 20,000 other weirdos that were just like me. I think that was the first time I ever saw that many gay people in one room before. It was so powerful. We didn't know where we were gonna sit because we had to collect the tickets at will call at the box office. And so I go up to the box office window and I said, hi, like I'm here to get these tickets. I don't know where we're supposed to sit, because we had, you know, been given the tickets through this charity. And I was thinking, you know, we'll probably get some nosebleed tickets. And I told my friend, I was like, look, I'm sorry, they're not going to be great, but at least we're going to get to go to this concert that everybody wants to be at. So the box office person hands me the tickets, and they're fucking front row. They're front row tickets to like the hottest concert in America at the time. And it was just amazing. It was amazing. It was so amazing. Oh my God. We get there and the music is just blasting and the costumes are amazing. And I was 14 years old, so I couldn't even drink, but I was drunk on life. I was like, oh my God, this is everything, everything and more. And I remember her giving this speech at the show that it brought me to tears. Like, I even remember still hearing it.
My name is Lady Gaga! And welcome to the last of five shows at Madison Square Garden. I feel so blessed. You have no idea. I grew up 20 blocks from here, and I watched every name go up on that marquee year after year, month after month. And I used to dream that one day I'd see my name in lights. So thank you so much. Thank you for buying a ticket to see my show. And for those of you who didn't pay for your tickets, I want my money back. I'm just kidding. You know, I didn't used to be brave. In fact, I wasn't very brave at all. But you have made me brave, little monsters. And New York made me brave. So now, I'm gonna be brave for you. Tonight, I want you to forget all of your insecurities. I want you to reject anyone or anything that's ever made you feel like you don't belong, or don't fit in, or made you feel like you're not good enough, or pretty enough, or thin enough, or can't sing well enough, or dance well enough, or write a song well enough, or like you'll never win a Grammy, or you'll never sell out Madison Square Garden. You just remember that you're a goddamn superstar, and you were born this way. May tonight be your liberation of all those things. Because I used to pick up my leather boots on that street, and I would go down the stairs to the 9 train, and I'd take the 9 train downtown, and then I'd get on the L train to go across town. And I'd go to dance class, and I would pray, and I would dream that someday one person would believe in me. So when you leave here tonight, know that at least one person believes in you.
It's like electrifying every single person in the room, and we're all screaming back at her and sweating and dancing and jumping. And I just remember like literally feeling out of my body. Like I had never felt like that before. Like just so at home and so free. It honestly felt like going to church or something like that. And, you know, I came back and I remember telling my friend, you know, I don't want to tell anybody that we went to this concert because they're going to make fun of me. And I remember her telling me, like, you know, who the fuck cares? Why would you care about that? I saw you, and that was the happiest I've ever seen you. And you should be proud of that. And you should feel like it doesn't matter what people think about you. It's music, and it's things that make you happy. And you should want to share that with other people. And if they don't fuck with it or don't want to hear it, then it's their problem, not yours. I think what I learned from that experience was that it doesn't really matter what other people think. Even at 14 years old, you know, I still didn't want to be gay. But what I realized was that it was such an amazing experience and such a life-changing experience that wasn't worth hiding from anyone. And I think it was the first time in my life that I had really felt something that had changed me as a person. And I had the confidence, I think, to be able to share that with people and not really care. And I was made fun of for it. And I was kind of like, you know, people were snickering and like, oh, is he gay? Like, blah, blah, blah. But I think that was really when I started to think, like, who cares if you think that I'm gay? Because I went to this concert and there were thousands of gay people there, and they were fucking awesome. And they were singing along to all the songs that I love and dancing just like me. and enjoying the music just like me and just as obsessed as me. That was the first time I had visibility into queer people and queer life. And that was the first time in my life when I thought to myself, being gay isn't an insult. People can't insult me when they call me gay, because now I've seen gay people and they're fucking amazing and they're cool and they love the same shit as I do. And little would I know, well, I probably didn't know that I'd be one of them just a few years later.
Oh, yay. Yeah. Oh,
that's so lovely. That was my story of how Lady Gaga made me gay.
Yay. I'm pleased. Welcome. I'm very glad. So, when you were obsessed with, I've forgotten what song it was you said. Was that Bad the first Romance. Time you'd heard? Yeah, Bad Romance. Was that the first song you heard of Gaga's as well? Was that the first thing you heard and you were just like, this speaks
no,
to me?
No, so I had heard, you know, her first songs like Just Dance and Poker Face and all of those songs, but Bad Romance, just, it was different for me. Like, that one was the first one that I think was like, that was like truly a gay anthem. You know, the other ones were like gay adjacent, like the gays love those. But Bad Romance, I felt like that was for the gays. Like, that was an anthem, you know?
I think I have some very kind of fuzzy gin soaked memories of hearing kind of that rah rah ramana and like just like, oh, we must dance and like running out, like charging for the dance floor and all that kind of thing when that came on, that I wouldn't have done for, you know, Just Dance or for anything else because it wasn't as good. And yeah, like a Bad Romance and Telephone were definitely the big ones for me, so I can very much empathize with you.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. I think they, you know, that music till this day, it brings together queer people in a way that a lot of music just doesn't do, you know. It's, I think, nostalgic for a lot of us. And it was oftentimes, for so many of us, some of the first music that we felt like we could feel safe with, you know, and sort of music that touched us in a way for the first time.
Stuff like Bad Romance and Telephone, it was a little bit grittier, a little bit sexier. Before then, it was kind of neutered and kind of innocent and fluffy and kind of like Bewitched and fucking Spice Girls and stuff like that. Yeah, it was good, but it was a bit like, Gaga had a bit more of a bite to her.
Oh, maybe. For sure. I think she's
a little bit edgy, a little bit sexier.
Edgy, yeah. But, you know, the gays, we've always had our queens, I think, starting from, true. You know, Judy Garland, even, and Beyonce and all of them, you know, everyone sort of has their woman that they, you know, idolize. And in a lot of ways, sometimes the older I get, the more I think that oftentimes these women are sometimes the first women to accept us. You know, sometimes we actually feel like we see in them a sister or a mother or a friend that we don't have in our own lives. You know, I think Lady Gaga maybe was the first woman in my life to actually embrace gay people that I had ever seen. You know, when we were at that show, I remember she had said, you know, in the chorus for Alejandro, I remember that one of the dancers hoisted her up and she, when the music had break, she said, "Put your hands up in the air if you believe in gay marriage." And the whole audience started roaring. And this was before gay marriage, like years before gay marriage was legalized in America. And again, even though I didn't know that I was gay at the time, to see someone so unabashedly unapologetic about loving queer people and loving queer life, it was powerful. And I think a lot of gay people have that similar experience with her or with other powerful women.
So have you been to concerts since? Do you still go and see her live when she's on and stuff like that?
Yeah, I actually went to the Chromatica show. You know, I haven't been able to catch her as much over the years. And, you know, I think my life has kind of changed in a lot of ways since I was 14. I feel so grateful to have been at the age that I was when she was sort of touring that record and when that particular music came out, because I don't know, it was just a certain time and a place that sort of made that so amazing. And I love that. I miss that.
Yay. And now you get to do that, not so much through music, but through your life. You get to be embodying those same ideals and being like welcoming and supportive of the queer community. So no pressure, but you know, your turn now.
Well, you know, queer youth are really important to me. And I think given what I went through growing up in such a deeply conservative environment as a gay person, it is really important to me to make space for young queer people and for them to know that they have a future that is beautiful and bright and gorgeous. And that's kind of the essence of a lot of my work and who I am. So I think in a lot of ways, yeah, it's about kind of reaching back and giving those experiences that I had to young people too.
Oh, yay. All right, let's pay some bills. What do you want to plug? What do you want to tell us about?
Well, you know, I'm always happy to talk about Lady Gaga.
Of course.
Yes, and the Monster Ball days. But, you know, it's funny that the story kind of ties into a lot of my work. I, you know, am really thoughtful about queer youth and sort of the importance of creating a future for them that feels like a future they want to live in and that they can live in and believe that they will thrive in. And for me, you know, at that age, one of the reasons that I think I was so closeted was because I had never seen amazing gay people doing amazing things, you know, queer people having sustainable and loving relationships with friends or with partners. And so the project that I'm actually working on is all about creating those role models for young queer people. So the show, it's a podcast with iHeartMedia. It's called But We Loved. And basically it's about teaching queer history to young people. But the twist is that it's told through my interviews with queer elders. And so they talk about the amazing history that they lived. And I think when I was growing up, I always thought that, you know, being gay would be like the worst thing I could ever be because it had such a bad branding. I mentioned earlier, like, I thought I'd die of AIDS or I thought I'd be alone. But now as a journalist, you know, as I sort of dive into the history of our community, I found that there are so many profound stories of courage and perseverance and love. And so really what I hope to do is inspire young people with these amazing stories that can show them that, you know, you come from a really rich lineage of bravery and of love.
Aww. So it's called But We Loved with one T in but, presumably.
It is, yes, for search purposes, but if you sort of envision it being with two T's, you're more than welcome to. But yes, nice. For search purposes, you can type in But We Loved wherever you get your podcasts. And each episode is around 40 minutes or so. But I hope that you'll walk away having learned something, having met a new role model, and having been inspired as well.
What's your kind of beat?
My beat?
In journalism?
It's a little unique. So I actually report on anything and everything that is impacted by shame. So basically, society and shame, shame in society and its impact on society is what I report on. And so I've done some really interesting reporting on HIV, living with HIV, on abortion, on being medicated for mental illness. It's a really broad beat, but I find that it's so intriguing because everyone is impacted by it in some way, you know?
Wow. Awesome. Yeah. Like, I think it's a, so apart from your amazing work teaching the youngins with the help of the elders, where else can people find you on the internet if they want to look you up and all that?
Yeah, you can find me on Twitter and on Instagram and on TikTok at @jor_Gonsalves. And you can also find the show, But We Loved, on any of those platforms at But We Loved.
That was Probably True, the LGBTQ plus storytelling project created to remind all of our queer siblings that we are none of us alone. If you liked it, then comment, share, subscribe, and join the Patreon. Or just tell all your friends. If you didn't like it, tell me. Come at me, bro. Okay, yes, Probably True has been invited by the Cheerful Earful podcast to be on stage for an hour live in London's glittering Balham on the 20th of October 2024. I'll be there talking rubbish, chatting away. I would love it if you could come too. There is a link in the show notes for where you can buy tickets. Do buy them quick because they are in hot demand, shall we say. It's very exciting. I'm looking forward to doing it and I would love to see you there. There's a link in the show notes or go to the Probably True link tree, which is linktr.ee/probablytrue, and you can find all of my upcoming events there. Come on, be great to see you. And if you want to support me and can't make it, then just buy a ticket anyway. I don't mind performing to an empty room as long as I'm getting paid. Anyway, see you next week. Goodbye. I love you.